I'm Mick Dumke of the Sun-Times.
And I'm Ben Jarofsky from The Reader.
And we're here the first Tuesday of every month, as many of you know, for the show that we creatively called First Tuesdays. And thank you for coming back if you've been here before. I know there's a lot of repeat visitors. And thank you for coming out for the first time, if that is the case for you. We're really excited about this show. Now, we had hoped to have Double Trouble up here, of course. Those of you who saw the notice we sent out about the show, we'd hoped to have both Don Rose and Tim Black, a legendary educator, historian, and activist in Chicago who, among many other things, helped organize the March on Washington. The Midwestern component got people out to Washington for that great day in 1963. Unfortunately, we got word just yesterday he was not going to be able to make it. So we're disappointed he's not here, but we're very glad that Tim is still kicking strong in well into his late 90s at this point in time. 97 years old. So we're sorry that he's not here, but hoping that we're going to get him back. Yeah. But we're not going to dwell on that because we have the also very, very great Don Rose with just a phenomenal and phenomenally interesting career that he's had.
Yeah, well, with originally the show was going to be Tim Black and Don Rose, who are all allies and friends, reminiscing and talking about the summer of 66, which is 50 years ago, where Dr. King brought his movement for open housing and justice and all good things to Chicago and was met with much resistance from Mayor Daley, the old Mayor Daley. Anyway, not the new Mayor Daley. Since
any Mayor Daley's to come.
Or any Mayor Daley. Yeah, you may know more than I do, Don. So anyway, we're going to adjust it a little bit. We won't be talking about the summer of 66 and civil rights. We'll be discussing Chicago politics then and now. And just so you know, I don't know if many of you know about the man on my left here, Don Rose. Is a personal hero of mine. He's a legend in Chicago. When I moved to town in 81, my boss at the time said, you got to go interview Don Rose. That was John McDermott. And so I've been interviewing him one way or another ever since. I'm just going to run down.
And one of the first people I was told to interview when I worked at the Chicago Reporter 18 years after you was also
Don Rose. Yeah. You had to work that 18 years after me into that line, didn't you?
The reason I'm sorry Tim is not here is that he is the only guy who makes me feel like a kid.
Yeah. Yeah. He's 97 years old, yeah. So here's some of the campaigns that Don Rose has worked on since the 60s. Number one, and this is, I put this number one because it's my favorite. I don't know if Don would put it number one. He was the political strategist behind Jane Byrne's 1979 successful mayoral run when she defeated Michael Bolandic and proved to the world that Chicago voters aren't always stupid. He was Martin Luther King's press secretary when King brought his movement to Chicago in 1966. He was the press secretary for the anti-war protesters in 1968 when the Democratic Convention was in town. I think I see a few of protesters in this room. A Klonsky or two is running around here. He was a political strategist for Bernie Kerry in 1972, a tremendously important campaign in Chicago history. That's when black voters throughout the West and South Side voted Republican for Bernie Kerry in order to defeat Edward Hanrahan, who is the Democratic nominee, to punish him for his role in the Black Panther killings, the Fred Hampton and Mark Clark. He was an advisor to Harold Washington and his communications director for his 87 campaign. I don't know how well this will do with everybody in this audience, but he's the mentor for David Axelrod, taught that kid everything he knew. You can blame Don for everything that's gone wrong since. Tons of aldermanic campaigns, some legends that he's worked with, William Cousin, Leon Dupre, Sammy Rayner. He's worked with Danny Davis, Bobby Rush, Paul Simon, and he was also a senior advisor to Jesus Garcia, so he's still active to this day. And of course, we'll be discussing that campaign and what went wrong and what went right with it. So anyway, Don, thanks for coming here.
Well, glad to be here. And if you're talking, thank you. My favorite campaign of all, which, if they put one on my tombstone, it'll probably be Jane Byrne.
Yeah.
But it was defeating the murderer Edward Hanrahan that I consider my coup.
Well, why don't we just talk about that for a moment? That is a very important campaign. I alluded to it a little bit in the introduction, but why don't you fill folks in on that a little bit? The significance of that was in 1972, correct?
The election was 72. I assume that most of you would be familiar with the murder of Fred Hampton in 1969, where Hanrahan, at that time the state's attorney, had his own police force, or his own police squad assigned to him by the police department. So they were basically the state's attorney's police. And on a midnight raid, December of 69, they assaulted, and in the pre-dawn hours, as the newspapers always say, they assaulted the home of Fred Hampton and other associates in the of Black Panther movement, part of a national campaign to destroy the Black Panther Party. And Fred Hampton, it was originally described as a shootout, and it was really a shoot-in. There was one bullet went out, and hundreds went in. They killed Fred in his bed, and Mark Clark, his associate, two people died. And it was no accident, as you will read in several accounts. They went in and literally finished Fred off when they thought he might still be moving in his bed. Somebody went in and just popped a couple of other bullets in him just to make sure. Now it takes 16, as you know.
Somehow or that happened in 69, and the election wasn't until 1972.
Right.
And as you recall, Hanrahan was victorious in the Democratic primary. I believe there was opposition, wasn't there?
Well, we had a three-way primary in late fall of 71. Hanrahan was originally re-endorsed by the party, and there was so much protest that they disendorsed him and endorsed a judge named Raymond Berg.
Yes.
Well, meanwhile, the progressives, the liberals, the independents in town endorsed a fellow named Donald Page Moore, who was a former federal prosecutor who had been involved in, he was an ACLU lawyer and quite a guy. And we ran a hell of a campaign, and in the three-way split, Hanrahan won. And running against him on the Republican side was a fellow named Bernard Kerry, who had previously tried to run for sheriff. These are the days we had liberal Republicans. I know that that's... some of you may be old enough to remember that term.
Yeah.
Kerry was a pretty decent guy, and he had lost a race to Richard Elrod, who was one of the old machine hacks out of the West Side movement. And he came very close to defeating Elrod in 1970. Anyway, he runs again. And
that was for sheriff?
That was for sheriff, yeah. Against Elrod. we could talk about that race forever. The bottom line is Bernie, who I had known from his run against Elrod, asked me to, after Donald Page Moore lost, if I would take over his campaign. And I was able, fortunately, and rather easily, to bring most of the people who were for Don Moore in. And the key was breaking the black community loose from the Daily Machine. And we carried every black ward except two, and those we lost by, you know, a handful. A lot of the suburbs, which normally voted Republican, voted Democratic for Hanrahan because they kind of liked the idea of having a racist murderer.
As their state's attorney.
But for yeah. state's attorney. Yeah. And anyway, the bottom line was we whipped his ass pretty good. And I say that he was probably the worst state's attorney in modern history. And the second worst state's attorney in modern history turned out to be a woman named Anita Alvarez. And so, what is it, 30, whatever the hell many years since then, I was very proud to become a senior advisor to Kim Fox, and we whipped Anita Alvarez's ass pretty good, too.
Well, Don, can you talk a little bit about how you actually managed to win that election in 1972? This was, of course, at the time when the, you know, Democratic machine was presumably sort of invincible. At least that's the perception we have, sort of, you know, from hindsight or looking backward. How did you do it? How did you manage to, you know, remind? Did you have to remind people that 2 years earlier this incident, or was that just, you know, the thing that you, that people are already aware of, and you just had to kind of get folks organized?
Well, a little of both. From the time King was here in Chicago in 65, 66, we began to elect a number of independent state senators, aldermen, and so on, and began the process of breaking the black community away from the old machine. I wish Tim was here who could elucidate on this a great deal more. I used to refer to myself as a reverse wash machine. Most wash machines are white and they have black agitators inside. I was a white agitator inside a black machine. Anyway, we had people like.
Sorry, Don. It caught up to me.
we had people like Sammy Rainer, Bill Cousins, and in just rising young men like Bobby Rush and Danny Davis, who were literally kids at the time. And of course, in the years between the murder of Fred and the race for state's attorney in 72, Don Moore had actually received in the Democratic primary a plurality of the black vote. And so the setting was right. You didn't have to tell people very much, except this guy is running against Hanrahan, the murderer, and don't mind the fact that he's a Republican. Just all you have to do, you pull your Democratic lever, and then when you come to state's attorney, just switch down. Those are the old days with the voting machines where you had a straight party vote, and if you wanted to vote independently, you could push down an individual lever and push up the Democrat. So it was an education process, but the time was right. Those were the days, in fact, when we were beginning to think about electing independent aldermen on the north side. In 1969, we elected a fellow named Bill Singer in the old 44th ward, and then in a special election, and then there was a little redistricting, and in 71, a fellow named Dick Simpson, who I'm sure is familiar to most of you, took over the 44th Ward, and Bill Singer was in the, then moved to the 39th Ward, or 43rd Ward, I should say. So we had the beginnings of a lakefront movement. Among my phrase making, I'm sorry to say that I, because it's no longer true, coined the phrase lakefront liberals. And so between the lakefront liberals, a suburban uprising in places like Oak Park and Evanston, where a lot of people from Hyde Park had moved, and a huge vote in the black community.
Yeah,
we pulled it off. It was it was more an education job of saying this is how you beat Hanrahan, because there was beginning to be a built-in anti-Hanrahan vote. So I can't say that we changed a lot of minds. We just did a lot of pretty simple voter education and get out the vote.
Okay, let's go back a little bit before we go forward from there. Don, tell us a little bit about...
I'm a little bit backward, but I still read the forward.
Well, tell us about how you got into politics and civil rights activism in the first place.
Oh, goes back a long way. My first political work was in 1947 when I thought a fellow named Henry Wallace was going to make a good president. And I had previously, as a kid from age, 9, 10, 11, read about socialism, read about Karl Marx, read about democracy. I was raised in a Roosevelt household. And I'm what the folks today would call self-radicalized. And so when I had my first opportunity, we couldn't vote at age, I was 17 going on 18, I guess, that year, and we couldn't vote till we were 21, but I went to my first political meetings, which were progressive party meetings, and handed out literature, did running on election day, just the usual simple ass stuff that a smart-ass 17-year-old kid would do.
And you grew up what, on the northwest side?
Grew up I was born in Rogers Park and then moved to West Rogers Park. I developed, my parents weren't highly political. They were Roosevelt Democrats of the 30s and the early 40s. And the one lesson I got from my mother that just sort of stayed with me, and I never really changed very much. I heard we had a housekeeper who was black, and she would occasionally bring her daughter around to when she came to work in our household. Her daughter was my age, a girl named Sally Smith, and played out in the backyard, and somebody called her a nigger. Excuse the word, folks. I was a little distressed. I hadn't really heard much of the word before, and I asked my mother about it, and she said in her pretty simple way, don't associate with anybody who says nigger, because if they'll say nigger in front of you, they'll say kike behind your back. And that was a kind of a lesson that stayed with me. I haven't changed much.
Well, all those years that you were working in politics, getting your start, did old man Daley ever try to bring you over to the other side? Did he ever say, hey, bet you can make more money with us, or did he ever try that?
He had an emissary who worked very hard at doing that, a fellow named Phil Crone.
Okay, yeah.
Many of you know the name, the late Phil Krohn, yeah, who was a kind of an entertaining guy. And I think I knew Phil since he was barely old enough to vote. I don't remember exactly where I met him. He started as a Republican and worked with independents, as we did in those days with so-called liberal Republicans. And then when he went over to the dark side very soon, he did a lot of stuff. He was one of the great bullshit artists. Yeah. But the problem is that the thing you thought was the biggest piece of bullshit would turn out to be true.
Yeah.
So you never knew what to believe. Anyway, Phil devoted much of his career, right down to I think the year he passed away, to trying to bring me over and get me to do something with or for one or the other of the dailies. And he ran his wife was made a Democratic candidate, tantamount to election for a judge, when Phil was knew he was in his last years. And his last request to me was, could I put your name in an ad with Richie Daley for my wife? And I said, okay. And so there exists someplace an ad that said, here's one thing Richie Daley and Don Rose agree on.
Well, what was it about the Daleys that always put you on the other side of the fence from them?
Well, when I was a young man and an avid reader, as I say, before I went to any political meetings of any kind, I did read all about political machines. I learned the history of the Chicago machine and the Tammany Hall and so on. And developed a general belief that this was, in fact, the kind of authoritarianism that could border on fascism. My own little noodling head said that. And as I saw and learned more about Daley the Elder and his role with race, his control, and so on, and observed from his very first election on how he took over the machine and broke up or I should say beheaded the various ethnic leaders like Bill Dawson, who headed the black machine, and Jake Arvey, who headed the Jewish machine on the west side and so on. I saw incipient fascism. And I always tried to avoid using the word because it was a turnoff word. But if you think about a police state, what Daley had, what Daley developed, was in fact the use of a police force, both in the polling places and through his spy system, the Red Squad. I saw the development of a politician using a police or military force for political ends, which is fundamentally the definition of a police state, if you don't want to use the word fascism. And I saw it modified through the years, but the game, some of the faces changed, some of the rough edges got filed off, but that's what I saw. And Chicago, growing up in Chicago and going through all these years, began to realize that the manipulation of race has been the Chicago way almost from the very beginning, from the days that the African-American community was Republican and sent the first black congressman to Washington, who was a Republican, who then soon as was Bill Dawson, who then soon switched. But if you see Chicago's segregation, we could go through this whole history. You know, Chicago was not segregated by accident. Every instrumentality of government was used to create or maintain segregation, the most important of which in 1947, when the National Housing Act was passed, which permitted the building of large numbers of public housing units, the first thing that the Chicago City Council did, pre-Daley, was take a vote that gave each alderman the right to accept or reject public housing in his neighborhood. There were no hers then. And the African-American alderman on the, what was then maybe three or four or five in the plantation, all wanted to have the public housing because they would have in effect subservient needy people, and the whites didn't want it. And so that was probably the greatest single move to sustain and enhance the segregation that we had in the city.
Well, by the early 60s, you have this sort of, in some ways it seems like paradox, where I believe Richard J. Daley was reelected in 1963 in large part because of the black vote, right? In a very tough race against Adamowski, an old childhood rival or you know, early rival.
Yes, he basically was in his first race.
Right.
55. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So he wins the vote, but at the same time, there is this simmering discontent, and it starts around the schools, right? And then it moves into housing and other issues. And I know you were involved in doing some work around the March on Washington in 1963 from Chicago.
Yep.
But then this eventually, some of the same activists ended up inviting Martin Luther King to come to Chicago in 1965 and the 1966
right.
for his campaign. Can you tell us a little bit about that? How did that come to be, and how did you get involved?
Well, we'll go back to 63. We had put together a group of civil rights organizations, community organizations, and so on and so forth. Started with about 15 or 20 traditional groups and grew up to 50 or so, called the Coordinating Council of Community Organizations. And Tim Black was one of the prime actors in it. He headed the March on Washington, and we organized that. We later organized a massive school boycott in the fall of 63 that emptied every black school in the city. There were probably not 500 black kids in school in this protest. It was one of the most successful civil rights protests, and we had a number of projects. We had another boycott in 64, and over school segregation and the lack of services. And Dr. King, somewhere I guess in after the Democratic Convention of 64, decided that he should open up a Northern Front. After the Voting Rights Act was passed in Selma, and I was the press secretary and sort of political guru for the CCCO when we were doing all of these projects, the school boycott, the March on Washington, and also trying to chase the House Un-American Activities Committee out of Chicago, which we did fairly successfully. They never held another outside of Washington meeting after the demonstrations we put on in around 65. And Dr. King wanted to have a Northern Front, and he was looking at several cities. They thought they were going to go to Harlem, but they went. We're going to look at Chicago, Buffalo, Detroit, Cleveland, and so on. And we invited him in for a long weekend where we had set up a very successful series of meetings throughout the city in all the black communities and set up a big fundraising thing for him on the Winnetka Village Green and so on. And he was very impressed by this. The only place that the only protest was coming from Andy Young, who wanted Harlem, and they went to Harlem and they found that the groups in Harlem were fighting each other harder than they were fighting the man. So Dr. King says, Chicago it is. And the way King worked, he would merge the Southern Christian Leadership Conference with the local civil rights group, like the Birmingham, and when he did this, when he went to Birmingham, and when he went to Selma, and so on. And we created what was called the Chicago Freedom Movement, and it was co-led by Al Raby, for whom I had been acting as press secretary at the CCCO, and Dr. King. And Dr. King needed a lot of information about Chicago politics, and so I became sort of his political advisor and local PR guy. He had a national PR fellow named Junius Griffin, but I handled all the local stuff and wrote speeches and did all the usual thing and indoctrinated the poor doctor about Mayor Daley and what to look out for.
Were you actually in the meetings that King had with Mayor Daley in those days, or were that was not your role?
No, I was a little too radical for that. They there were one or two leftists in there, but Rose did not have a welcome mat.
And so what was Daley's attitude? Nowadays, of course, Martin Luther King is one of the most celebrated heroes in America. Now that he's no longer with us, what was it? How was he treated in good old Chicago when he was very much alive and among us? How did
he was very, very politely many, many times asked to go back to the South. There was a fellow named Charlie Swibel who used to run the Chicago Housing Authority, who was his main emissary and who would come in and say, well, Dr. King, what we're going to do is put a social worker in every public housing high-rise in the city, if you will only go away, and that sort of thing. And rather than that, you know, that he wouldn't be bought off, but you may remember that there were some very violent marches that took place. The marches for open housing were not the original plan. If I can go into...
Oh, yeah, that was in the summer of 66.
In 66. Yeah. The plan was very broadly to end not just slum housing, but schools, desegregate the schools, health care, economics, and so on. The economic arm was modeled after something in Cleveland called Operation Breadbasket, and this was run by ministers, and because of all the competition among ministers, they decided that they would get a neutral, unknown figure to be the head of Operation Breadbasket, and his name was Jesse Jackson. He didn't stay neutral and unknown very long.
No, it didn't take long.
wasn't quite in his DNA.
Anyway, the housing end of the program was a testing thing, which still goes on in a lot of places today, where we'd pick neighborhoods that were a mile outside of the ghetto lines. At one point, it was Ashland Avenue, and into communities that were of the economic level that African Americans could afford to live in. And a white couple would go to a real estate agency and be shown someplace in the white neighborhood. A black couple would go in and they'd be shown someplace in the black neighborhood only. That's all we have available. And then another white couple would come in and, of course, be shown in the white area. And there was one, can't remember the name of the place, up around Kedzie, 63rd and thereabouts in Kedzie, where we held a vigil. And as night set, there was about, maybe 50 or 60 black and white vigilers. And as the evening went on, as the sun went down, more and more whites started coming around and yelling and started throwing things. And neither Dr. King nor Al Raby were at that particular one. And James Bevel and Jesse cut a deal with the police that the police would, in their vans, take the protesters back to our headquarters on the south side on 79th Street. And so you had the TV showing protesters being led into the police vans. And when we got back, Al was then came in. He was furious. He called Dr. King. They were furious. And we said, how the hell are we going to, recover from this? And we don't use terms like this anymore, but the line was, we have to recapture our manhood. And I, among others, said, let us hold a march back to that real estate agency. Well, that march took us through Marquette Park itself, and we were met with rocks and stones, and cars were burned. I don't know if there's anybody here who was on any of those, but it was a horrendous scene. And all along the way, once west of Ashland Avenue, there were these kids throwing rocks and bottles, and the cops were on the other side. They would occasionally pick up some white kids who were throwing rocks, drive them a couple of blocks away, and let them go. This didn't set well with Daley because it made national news, and so when we set up the next march, the police actually protected us, except going through Marquette Park, Dr. King was in there and he was hit by a brick. That's when he fortunately was not seriously injured. He fell down, he was put back on his feet, and that's where he made his statement about, I'm approximating, I've never seen as much hatred in the South as I did here in Chicago. Well, the marches continued. We went into, a dozen neighborhoods or so with police protection, and Daley was consistently embarrassed by this, but he did make sure that we were not attacked violently, but he went to some of his cronies who, in those days, the machine controlled the federal courts. Law partners of Daley were made federal judges, and they got an injunction against the marches. And then this so-called summit meeting was called.
Yeah. Were you at the summit meeting?
That's the one where I was.
You were not allowed in the summit meeting either? Oh my God, you're too radical for the summit meeting.
I was in other meetings with King, but it was the summit meeting that I thought you were referring to.
No, I was just wondering if there were private meetings in the back in City Hall where Dr. King was ushered in, if you were ever in any of those, but apparently you
were
not.
Oh, the smaller meeting. No, I wasn't in those. Those were, three or four people.
Yeah. No, the famous summit meeting, of course.
But the summit, I was too much below the summit.
Yeah, okay.
Well, the summit meeting, I think, has been sort of widely, or the summit or the agreement that they eventually came up in with has been widely viewed as a defeat for, you know, Reverend King and for the civil rights effort in Chicago, that, you know, essentially all the promises that Mayor Daley made were vague, and they weren't, you know, there wasn't much beyond, you know, these sort of abstract promises to do better and that sort of thing. What's your view of thing in retrospect? Is that the case, or was there something else that came out of that movement?
I think if you look at the long term, a number of things came out. tell you just one little story. During King's stay, we had an election for the state Senate, and we elected two black independent state senators against the machine. One of them represented the Hyde Park South Shore area, a very well-spoken, handsome fellow named Richard Newhouse, who many people used to say he could be the first black president. Well, when Newhouse left, a woman named Alice Palmer came in, and Alice Palmer tried to run for Congress, and another well-spoken young man with an Ivy League education won that seat and did become the first black president. So there's a chain. We also, Dr. King wanted some national legislation to come out of each of his campaigns. Out of Birmingham came the Civil Rights Act. Out of Selma came the Voting Rights Act. And since we were sort of pushed into representing primarily open housing, by 68, a very weak national open housing law was passed, but it was weak because King had been killed. If King had been alive, that would probably have been a stronger bill. So a number of things took place, but I think the most important thing to come out of King's years in Chicago was an awakening throughout the black community about what it meant to be subservient to the machine. And, you know, we elected our first independent alderman soon after that, Sammy Rayner, Bill Cousins. Bill Cousins then later became the first independent judge to be elected inside the city of Chicago. We began to have more and more black candidates. We had, you know, to go back, the base was being built for the campaign against Hanrahan. 4 years later, after Hanrahan was defeated, Ralph Metcalf, a pinion of the machine, switched. And Daley tried to dump him, and we destroyed the opposition in that campaign. Metcalf won a congressional district by 72%. It was soon after that we elected two more African-American congressmen. So one's name was Harold Washington. The other's name was Gus Savage. So I look upon this political building as links in a chain, and central to that was the awakening of 1966.
Mm-hmm. But to really come fast forward, not to get one of my bleak moments here, you worked in the Jesus Garcia campaign, and of course, that was sort of regression in many ways. If you think of the black electorate as the key component in terms of defeating the machine or whatever, if Rahm is a machine, I'm not quite sure what Rahm is. but so your thoughts on that? I mean, when you take a look at the election of 2015, the mayoral election, when so many of the voters on the West and the South sides went for Rahm over Garcia, are you as disillusioned? Do you feel that it's a regression from 66?
You know, I think it was a regression for Barack Obama to not only endorse him, but come in and make commercials for him. I think without that, the numbers might have been significantly different. I look upon that as one of the white marks on Obama's record. but I would also like to point out something else that we talked about earlier. You know, the hostility that you started to read about between of blacks against Mexicans, which they exploited very heavily, was done intentionally. This was not an accident any more than segregation was an accident in Chicago. When Ritchie Daley first won, he realized that another Harold Washington might arise out of the black community, and he began assiduously to court the Hispanic community, the Latinos, creating the Hispanic Democratic Organization, which you probably recall was later found to be illegal because of patronage and so on. And Daley very intentionally, using some of his own black aldermen, gave patronage jobs galore to Hispanics, Mexicans primarily, and when African Americans looked out on their streets to see who was digging up the sewers or who was collecting the garbage and so on, they saw Mexicans or some Puerto Ricans and began to feel left out, which they were, but it was very intentional. And the black, you know, subservient aldermen worked very, very hard to say that it's those Mexicans that are taking our jobs. It's those Mexicans who are causing problems, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So the hostility, which was not, I don't think, inherent prior to that time, was a planned and nurtured activity. And I think that too contributed to a lot of the more serious questions that some blacks raised about Chewy, in addition to the work that was that Obama was doing. It's very hard to beat Obama in Chicago. And if you add a little racial antagonism to it, it becomes a lot easier. And you know, I'm not sure that Chewy would really very much relish at this moment having won that race, considering all the crap we're going through right now. But I think these were defining issues.
And of course, you know, among white voters, a similar thing was happening where we kept hearing what, you know, Ben and I certainly agreed was coded language from the likes of your protege, David Axelrod. Not to blame you for that, Don. But saying, you know, essentially like, oh, Chicago needs a strong leader. We need a capable leader. Otherwise, the city could go the way of Detroit. I think Mark Kirk actually used the word Detroit, didn't he? You know, which, sure, Detroit has a lot of issues, but, you know, everybody knows the racial history of Detroit, too, and it seemed that these are not so subtle reminders to the white community. Hey, you got your guy. You better stick with him.
Well, there was a clear effort, a lot of dog whistles about the fact that this poor Mex didn't have any plan. Well, and that sort of became a legend. He didn't have a plan. Well, we could never quite, we didn't have the money or, you know, to put on enough on the air and elsewhere to say we've been campaigning for something like 4 months. We don't have a full plan yet because we don't know all the facts that are wrong with this lousy city. Rahm has been mayor for 4 years And he doesn't have a goddamn plan. And he still doesn't have a plan. But having the kind of money that Rahm did, he could sell all the things that were factual. You know, nobody really had the solution. Chewy was not going to stand up and say, we need a $7 billion tax increase. Nobody was going to do that. Rahm avoided it all through the, all through the campaign. There was this subtle and not so subtle anti-Mexican, anti-Latino theme running through most of those commercials. This guy's not smart enough to run Chicago.
Well,
why isn't he smart enough? Well, you know, figure it out for yourselves.
Why do you think Obama not only endorsed Rahm, but how many commercials did he do? At least two commercials that I could in the second run around. What was that all about, Tom?
I guess it's something you would call old loyalties. Obama was, you know, Obama had some ego involvement because he this is the guy that he picked to become one of his top people, his chief of staff, and not to endorse him would have been a kind of admission of error on his own part. So there was, you know, he had a combination of friendship, ego involvement, and a lot of his big givers were also there too. But money doesn't have much to do with politics. That's so.
Well, Don, I wanted to ask you about the Kim Fox, Anita Alvarez, the primary for state's attorney, Democratic primary for state's attorney. Is this a signal that things are going in a new direction? Is this just about the both the poor decision making and, let's be honest, the bad luck of Anita Alvarez, that this surfaced right before her election, where it didn't surface till after Rahm's election? Or does it signal something new?
Well, I think the independent African-American vote and even the Latino vote is being revivified. I would say if you talk to a lot of African-Americans, you'd find a bit of endorser's remorse about, particularly in light of what we know. I think things are changing. I think there's been, you know, continued progress. If you want to know something very ironic, Kim Fox ran up, as you know, Bernie Sanders did not do particularly well in the African-American communities anywhere. But Kim Fox ran up such huge margins and had such a large turnout of African-Americans to go against Alvarez that even though Sanders carried the Latino community and almost everything west of, somewhere between Halstead and Ashland Avenue, Damon on the northwest side, the southwest side, had Kim's margin not been as huge as it was, if, let's say, only a third of the voters had turned out, Bernie Sanders, despite losing the black community, would have won the city. Just and more great Chicago ironies. But we'll see what happens. I guess it's kind of rote to say that had we known about the McDonald case, it's quite possible that Rahm would not have been elected. And poor Chewy would be stuck with this mess.
Will you be working on, or are you working on, the next mayoral campaign?
I'm giving it a great deal of thought.
How do you see it coming? I know it's 2 years away. I started thinking about it the day after the last election ended.
You got to think two elections back.
Yeah.
Like a good chess game.
Yeah, well, when did Daley win? 89, I started always thinking about the next elections. So what do you think? Is Rahm running again? If he runs again, will the voters make the same wise decision that they made last time? What's your sense of things?
If I had to look at it right now, I would say it's at least even that he won't run. And if he does run, it's a little better than even that he'll lose. That's you know, from this vantage point. There's a lot of people thinking about running. Interestingly, one leading candidate will probably be Tom Dart, the sheriff, who, in my opinion, back in when Rahm first ran, what was it, 11?
Yes.
We've all tried to block it out.
I think Tom Dart probably could have defeated Rahm Emanuel in that race. But that's all speculation. I was did my best to urge Tom to run. I have to say proudly, I lived in the district he won, the congressional district he won, and gone through a couple of mayor's races now, and I have never once voted for Rahm.
Wait a minute. You never voted for Rahm when he was the Democrat on the ballot running against a Republican? You never, for Congress? You never voted for him, huh?
I voted for Don Rose those years.
Okay, you wrote yourself in.
That was one of the few things I can spell.
Well, you know, one of the problems, and before we turn the questions over to the audience, but, you know, Don, one of the problems with beating mayors is getting what Chicagoans consider credible candidates to run against the sitting mayors. This is something mm-hmm. Nick and I talk about all the time. And so in the last election, let's see, I'm going to go through this. I don't believe, like, for instance, none of the congressmen ran for mayor, nor they all. Tony Preckwinkle, who was had a commanding lead in the poll, chickened out. We ended up with Willie Wilson, Jesus Garcia drafted at the last minute, you know. So Will...
I think Karen Lewis was a very credible candidate. I can't say she would have won, but she was a very credible candidate, and it would have been a very close race.
But her, that just proves my point. She only was running because she couldn't talk anybody else into running.
Well, the only other person worth talking into was Preckwinkle, and she remains, to my mind, as Buddhistic as Mayor Daley was.
So, in other words, do you think our more prominent politicians are getting courage, or do they? Is it that Rahm looks so weak that even our Chicago politicians are willing to take that challenge?
Well, you know, 2-3 years ahead of time, there's all sorts of people start, you know, not throwing their hats in the ring, but sending out emanations.
Yeah.
the African American and white moneyed establishment is sort of behind City Treasurer Kurt Summers, mm-hmm. Who will have no financial problems. Now, whether he would run against Rahm, I do not know. We know that the name of Troy LaRiviere, the head of the Principals Association, is considering such a race. We know that Bridget Gaynor, who I think is my county board,
I think she is as well, yeah.
Member, mm-hmm. who has is a blank slate. of accomplishment.
Thanks for having me. She was here last month in this very seat where you're sitting, Don.
Yeah, I'm sorry I missed her.
Yeah.
If she decides to run, I would probably say something like, well, I elected a female mayor once before. How'd that work out?
Before we take questions, we have to ask you about that. How did that work out? Tell us a little bit about Jane Byrne.
Great Jane Byrne.
And why you were no longer a supporter of hers after she got elected.
Well, very quickly, after she, when she won, I was able to go to the city council, to people I knew, the Black Independents, and a number of other African Americans who had been with the machine but were thinking about new alliances, and a number of Northwest Side then machine aldermen, and said something like, we really don't like Podolyak very much, do we? And they said no, and I had a majority of 27, I think, lined up to go against Burke and Podolyak.
And these were the council powerhouses at the time, for those who don't remember or don't know the name.
One of them still is.
Yeah. If you remember the Washington era, it was the Podolyak 29, the group that said it was all politics, not race. You understand that. They were just against the guy with the wrong paint job. Anyway, meanwhile, her husband, the late Jay McMullen, and the aforementioned Charlie Swibel were working on Jane in another direction and said, look, you know, Rose did a lot for you, and some of those other guys did a lot for you. You couldn't have won without Dick Simpson and so on. But the bones, the city hall is lined with the bones of reformers. You'll be much better off if you go along with the guys who know the lay of the land, like Burke and Podolyak. All this was going on out of my earshot, and I announced to Jane one day, I've got your new city majority lined up, and we can get rid of what she used to call in the campaign the evil cabal. The cabalistas, I said, are through. I've got 27 aldermen who will be yours without them. I probably used language suggesting that they might lose all or part of their manhood. And she had 24 hours to make up her mind because she was going to go on a vacation. A well-deserved vacation, I must say. And she walked on that plane without turning back and looking at me. And I said, farewell, Lady Jane. And that was it.
So she had already cut her deal.
She had made her decision.
Yeah.
I later found out that Charlie Swibel used to send her flowers every day, and all she had was one rose.
Okay.
The questions were, what does Bodisic mean, and why did Tony Preckwinkle bow out despite apparently having this insurmountable lead over Rahm?
Well, Bodisic means Buddha-like, and when you went to the old man daily, he would give you an answer that sounded like the answer you want, but wasn't quite necessarily. And the next day, he could say, I didn't say that. And we used to refer to him as the Buddha when it came to things like that. Like, oh, Mr. Mayor, can I run for alderman of the 37th Ward next year? the 37th Ward is an excellent ward to run in. That sort of thing. And Tony never said why. And, you know, I'm a political analyst, not a psychoanalyst, so your guess is as good as mine. Oh, yes.
Reverend Jackson.
Reverend J.H. Jackson. He was Dr. King's great antagonist even before he came to Chicago. He was head of, now I'm going to get the names of these conventions wrong, he was head of what was at one time the, I believe, National Baptist Convention. And he was always described in the newspapers as a leader of, I think it was 5,300 Baptist churches. The fact is, Dr. King, relatively early in his career, helped found an alternative Baptist convention, the name of which escaped, you know, when you start talking this stuff to a Jewish kid, it gets a little difficult. Yeah. But anyway, Dr. King, in effect, took away close to half of the members of that National Baptist Convention, and maybe more than half. And J.H. Jackson, matter of fact, Tim Black, who is, I wish he was here, once led a picket of J.H. Jackson's church. There was a lot of rivalry. There is no question. Tim is the man who coined the term plantation politics. And that's what it was. There was a very, very substantial grouping of African-American ministers, businessmen, and so on and so forth, who were parts of the Daily Machine and very, very loyal. And they didn't think very much of the civil writers, as they used to call them.
Yeah, and the aftermath of this story, which was the question, was that was called South Parkway, right? The street.
It was originally called Grand Boulevard. And then it became South Parkway, and then it became... this was Mayor Daley's final tribute to how much he thought of Dr. King. He changed it to Martin Luther King Drive, and which discombobulated a lot of people at the very, very south end before racial change took place. Right. So it's irony after irony. I'm sorry for overlooking that. That's one. Anna Langford was an African-American woman, independent, who should have been called one of the two first women elected to the city council. By some strange happenstance, a woman from the north side, the 48th Ward.
Bellini.
Who?
Marion Bellini. Bellini.
No. Before that, another woman who, Mary Lou Hedlund. Mary Lou Hedlund technically became the first woman because she was elected in the first round, and Anna was elected in a runoff. Anna Langford was a great woman, and I regret not having mentioned her, who was in the second wave of African-American independents who were elected.
So they're a group calling for congressional hearings here, and it's at We the People, is that what you said?
We the People petition.
Okay, thank you.
Chicago
Alvin Thomas. Okay, great. Question is about the state of open housing now and the Keeping the Promise ordinance to basically make sure there's public housing across the city.
Well, that's the way it should have been in the beginning. And it's the biggest broken promise. Even after lawsuit after lawsuit found the CHA guilty of maintaining the segregation, and it was taken out of his hands. It was taken out of the hands of the CHA by the federal government, and they could never, I don't know how hard they worked at it, but because of this ordinance, which I think still holds, aldermen can still reject certain amounts of can reject public housing in their wards. And someday maybe, but it doesn't look that way, because there was another plan going on at the same time. We who were for open housing and scattered site, low density public housing from way back talked about getting rid of the high rises. And some nice Mayor Daley conceived of how we take a reform and turn it to my benefit. And so they started tearing down all the public housing. There was a wonderful section in the Sun-Times a week or two ago about everything that's gone on and the changes in public housing and the development of mixed income public housing. Well, somehow they forgot, they forgot to build the moderate income housing, just a little mental lapse, to take over, to take all the people who were being moved out of public housing and the surrounding slum areas. And somehow, over 10 years, we lost 200,000 African Americans who moved to the suburbs. Some of them may have moved to Atlanta, for all we know. But that was just an accident. It was an oversight. And it's the kind of planning that still goes on in this city. We still plan in and around race. And it just depends on who's in power. And obviously, the best mayor we had in the last half century ate a little too many ribs every Sunday and didn't ride his exercise bicycle the way he was supposed to. And the son of a bitch died on us. Yeah. I still have a friend who every so often goes out to his grave to yell at him. I do have to tell you one funny thing, you were just if I may, that you talked about, one ironic thing, you talked about J.H. Jackson's dismembered statute. The head of the school system, where Mayor Daley was really working hard to segregate the schools and keep them separate to keep white people in, was a guy named Ben Willis. Name you may know. One of the methods he used was to put in portable wagons in the schools, which my friend Nick von Hoffman called Willis wagons. They became his name. The campaign, we had a long campaign. The boycotts were against Willis. One of the things he did was overbuild in the white areas and overbuild in the black areas rather than build anything in between that might become integrated. Ben Willis became, you know, as well known in the North as all of those southern governors and sheriffs and what have you. We finally got rid of Ben Willis much too late, somewhere around 1965, I believe. Ben Willis moved to Florida, and he died in a place called Plantation, Florida.
Question is about Scott Wagespack.
Yeah. She's rooting for Scott Wagensbeck to run if Tom Dart doesn't run. Your thoughts on that?
Oh, I think he's an excellent candidate. I think he could have done well if he'd run the last time. Tom Dart's kids are all 8 years older than they were. I don't know how old Scott's kids are, and I have never discussed that issue with him. The last time I discussed, you know, him running for mayor was way, way back. And I don't know him very well, but he's certainly a commendable, commendable public servant. And by the way, if I may, I don't know if we're running over time. I can't help, speaking of commendable public servants, but say a word about my friend Abner Mikva, who was a giant in Chicago reform politics and a national figure in progressive politics, and a guy who just, he was elected as an independent state legislator. He elected as a congressman. He became the head of the Chief Justice of the Washington Court, often mentioned as a Supreme Court candidate. He became, in the post-Lewinsky period, he became an advisor to what's his name, Clinton, the guy who likes to meet people in airplanes.
Yeah.
He's a longtime friend and fairly regular lunch companion, and not just personally, but I think we will all miss having him. He just never stopped. He just turned 90. He created the, as a friend mentioned earlier, the Mikva Challenge. This is a role model for anybody who ever thought about running for public office.
You talked about in 1972 suburban voters crossing over and voting for the racist white guy. Is there a possibility of that happening on a large scale this time around with Donald Trump?
Well, all I can say is that there is a base. I don't think at this time that it's large enough to flip enough states. It could flip Pennsylvania. Could it flip Nevada? I'm not sure. Could it flip Ohio? The Democratic base is so the Democratic electoral base is so large that I don't believe, at least at the moment, that there are enough of these so-called disaffected, blue-collar, white workers, uneducated, et cetera, et cetera. Although one must take a little note of the book called Listen Liberal, which really tells the story of how the Democrats, who once were the party of working people, became a party of a certain white-collar elite. It was done by the same author who wrote Once a Matter with Kansas. And the book couldn't have come out at a better time. I can't predict those numbers. I can't predict what's going to happen. The only thing I would say is whatever the polls say now, don't pay any attention. I would not start paying attention to polls until at least a week after Labor Day. But, you know, the danger is there. I just don't think that it's fatal yet.
All right. Well, on that almost hopeful note, let's end this conversation for now. Don, thank you so much. We hope you'll come back and join us again. And I hope all you guys will come back and join us again. We'll be here next month. Thanks very much, guys. See you next time.